Among the industries hardest hit by the pandemic and economic turndown is the airline industry. This week, Air Canada announced a first quarter loss of more than $1 billion. That's just the months of January through March. The federal government has been hinting at some support for that industry, but there aren't any specifics yet. So what kind of financial fuel are airlines looking for? Jim Scott is the CEO of Flair Airlines. He joins us from Edmonton. Hi, Mr. Scott. Good to see you. Thanks for being with us.
Well, thank you very much for having me on.
I want to start off by asking you if you could describe for myself and our viewers exactly what the impact of coronavirus has been, or the pandemic more largely, has been on your airline.
Well, on our airline, on March 18th, we had an 87% load factor. And on March 28th, we had a 10% load factor. And we lost 95% of our revenue within 9 or 10 days. And we had to pivot very quickly. We went into the international charter work and into cargo. But for all intents and purposes, our forward bookings right now are 15% of what they were this time last year.
And give us a sense, because I know we're all familiar with the WestJets and Air Canada's of the world, but give us a sense of the size, the scope of your airline.
Well, we were poised this year to move 1.5 million passengers, to be profitable, to move passengers that are cost conscious. In other words, passengers that can't afford the other airlines, the full service airlines. We're about 30%, sometimes up to 50%, but average 30% below the other carriers. And we move first time travelers, friends and family, and people that price is very, very important to them, and they just simply wouldn't fly if they weren't flying on us.
So I know you've been in the industry a long time, and my understanding is even as a pilot, have you ever seen anything? I imagine you haven't, but how does this compare to other events that really drastically impacted airlines? I'm thinking of the crisis in 2008 or perhaps 9/11, of course.
Well, we had SARS before and we had 9/11. But I've walked the office building, and our office building was in the terminal at the end of March, and there was absolutely nobody in the terminal building. And it was a very eerie feeling to see, a space that is normally congested and everybody's moving around with their own little lives down to virtually nobody. And I've never seen that before in my life before, where basically people just stopped moving and they sheltered in place. Now we're starting to see some people come back, and we are actually seeing, an uptick in the amount of people that are flying. But for a good part, 30, 40 days, there was just nothing moving in the airline industry.
I know it's difficult to assess, and nobody has a crystal ball right now, but we saw, for example, Air Canada say they don't expect any kind of quote-unquote regular travel to resume until probably next year. They see the effects, the downward effect of this pandemic to last upwards of 3 years. What is your sense of how long your airline might be grappling with reduced demand?
Well, of course, we're in a different marketplace. We're in the domestic market, which is different than the international market. We're feeling that the demand will be back to 40% by the end of the summer, 60% by the end of the year, and we'll be back to our original pre-COVID passenger loads by May of 2021. But the issue for us right now, until there's a cure, a treatment, or a vaccine for COVID, 19, passengers are scared to fly, just like they were in 9/11. So we had to really take on measures to mitigate that risk, to where passengers feel that, the risk of picking up COVID-19 on an airplane is less than other risks they have in their lives. So we've had to take measures like we completely clean the airplane at every station stop. All the passengers come off. We clean with a product that has holdover time for 10 days on hard surfaces that kills the virus. We have everybody wearing masks. We disinfect each passenger as we come on. We don't allow sick passengers to fly anymore. There's social distancing, and there may even be passengers that want to purchase a seat or that doesn't have anybody next to them. So these are all mitigating circumstances, and we're going to have to put them in place until there's a cure or there's a vaccine to this virus.
So the sector itself appears to be looking for additional liquidity backstopped by the federal government. Is that an accurate description of what you're hoping to see from the feds?
That's absolutely correct. There's a liquidity problem in the airlines right now. There's difficult obtaining cash from the normal channels. And on a go-forward basis, everybody wants to be paid up front. So for the ground handlers, for the fuel, everybody wants to see the money, as they don't know which airline will be, has the ability to pay them. So what we're looking for the government is a loan, not a bailout, but a loan that's backed by the government 2 to 3 years. We will pay it back. We will pay the taxpayer back. But in order for us to go to the next phase, which is the recovery phase, we're going to have to put aircraft into the sky. They're not always going to be profitable, but we have to have some sort of certainty to the public. It's sort of like the chicken and the egg. What comes first? The flight has to be there before a passenger will book on it. And for us to put, flights into the air without knowing the actual revenue that will come in, we're going to need some sort of backstop, and that backstop should be in the form of loans that are backed by the government.
I'm glad you clarified loans versus a bailout, because that's certainly part of the discussion south of the border. And it does come up from a lot of viewers when the Prime Minister gets asked, what are you prepared to do for not only the airline sector, but the oil sector specifically? And I wonder what you'd say to those Canadians who are sort of nervous about any kind of corporate bailout. And I take your point, of course, you're not looking for a bailout, but they want to make sure, even if taxpayer money is loaned, that there is a return on that investment, that Canadians don't end up losing jobs. My understanding is, there's a U.S. investor has a 25% stake in your company. Just, they want to make sure that those jobs stay in Canada in the long run, as long as your company is in this country. What can you offer for those Canadians who are concerned about that?
Well, the first thing I can say is that we are a driver of jobs. For every 1,000 passengers that we move, the Conference Board of Canada says we create 3.3 jobs. So we're essential to the network of Canada that's actually flying, that connects people, and that there's flying at an affordable rate so that people that are locked out of the full service carriers are there. So the idea is that there is nobody else providing this service. We couldn't insure against this this pandemic. And I mean, we have insurance on our aircraft and on our businesses for everything. This is something way outside of the scope that we could take normal precautions against as a company. So we need the certainty so that we can provide the certainty to the public, so that when they want to go from Toronto to Halifax or Toronto to Vancouver, that they can plan their lives around knowing that the airline will be able to provide them that service, because they have a backstop. Without that backstop, you could see that you showed up for a flight and there's not enough passengers and they've canceled the flight or something like that. And that wouldn't be very good for the public, and wouldn't be very good for the economy.
Yeah, I totally understand the financial case, and I think most Canadians would as well. I guess my question to you is more, can you guarantee to Canadians that, I think they've seen, in instances like with Bombardier, where it's a loan, but you're seeing, a lot of Canadians who end up losing their job, or a partial, lots of loans to the auto sector, and we see plants now years later closing down. I know it's not a direct, causal relationship, but I think we hear from Canadians all the time who are nervous about giving companies loans without certain strings attached. And I'm just wondering what assurances you can provide Canadians if, in fact, their money does end up helping you keep your company going?
Well, I think one thing is that our market, which is the ultra-low-cost market or the discount market, is in every G7 country, and Canada was the last to get our product into the marketplace. And we can traditionally take about 15% of the market, as we're the normal spot is, and we're at just like 1% of the market. So there's lots of growth here. So it's not that the government is trying to give money to maybe an oversaturated market or a market where they want to promote a Canadian product in a very competitive environment. What they're doing is that they are actually helping a product that they put in the market by changing the foreign ownership restrictions to encourage foreign investment in this particular market, which was the discount airfare market. And we can grow, you know, for 4, 5, 6 times and still have no problems being profitable. So I think in this particular sector, it's not a saturated sector. So I think the public can be assured that they are going to have what every other G7 country has, and that there's lots of room for growth for us in our particular sector.
Okay, I'm out of time. I have to leave it there. Thank you, Mr. Scott. Really appreciate your time.
Thank you very much, then.
Hi, I'm Vashi Capellos, host of Power in Politics. See more of our show by subscribing to the CBC News channel or click the link for another video.